Most of the news we watch these days centers on our present worldwide health crisis, but we really don't hear much about how it relates to diabetics. Are diabetics more likely to develop complications from this virus or any other virus that they might experience? I'll be interviewing an endocrinologist named Vladmir Carvalho, who is living in China where all this began, and I'll be asking his insights about our worldwide health crisis and diabetes. Well, folks, I'm happy and blessed to have Dr. Vladmir Carvalho, who is like an old friend now. I've interviewed him once before as he is studying in China. And Dr. Vladmir is an endocrinologist, and we are thankful that he is going to share with us. Dr. Carvalho, thank you for participating and being willing to do yet one more interview.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Thanks for having me here again.
Okay. So let's talk about diabetes and the coronavirus. Now, what I have read from the American Diabetes Association is that diabetics are not really any more likely to get the coronavirus than anybody else, but if they do get it, they're more likely to suffer complications from it or perhaps die from it. Is that how you see it?
Yeah, people with diabetes are more likely to die from almost anything. You know, because now we're talking about coronavirus, right? But normally there are some other viruses, other bacteria, there are many things that are trying to get into our body every day, every second. But our body will normally find a way to deal with it because our immune system, there are cells from our immune system that that can recognize any foreign body and destroy it. But when we have something tough like this COVID-19, like this SARS-CoV-2, that's the name of the virus, that can replicate this fast and can spread this fast, then your immune system also has to be fast. But for people with diabetes, they have a few problems. You know, I made a video about A1C, and I explained why we measure A1C, which is glucose attached to some molecules inside the red blood cells. And for us, we need to understand that glucose is not only in your body going up and down. They can be attached to different things in your body, different molecules, different proteins, lipids, and different things. So one of them is red blood cells, and we measure it as A1C. But other cells from your immune system, your blood vessels, other, you know, signaling molecules, they can also be glycated. They can also have sugar attached to them. And when sugar attached to them, sugar can change their structure or function or both. And that can trigger your body to recognize that things have changed and start some inflammation. That's why we say that patients with type 2 diabetes or, you know, or obese or things like that, we normally say that they have low-grade inflammation at all times if their blood sugar is higher than normal. So it's not actually about the corona thing. It's about your immune system that can't work properly because many things that are supposed to be working have sugar attached to them that will change their structure and function. To give you an example, if you look at our blood vessel, it looks like something long, like a tube, but it's not. It's just many cells, many small cells attached to each other that makes a long tube. So when your immune system needs to fight an infection, those cells, they need to be flexible and separate from each other and let the cells from the immune system with blood get to the area so that they can fight. But for people with type 2 diabetes or any other diabetes, their blood vessel will be impaired. So even if your immune system can come to the area, they will have a hard time getting to the real location. So that's why patients with, you know, type 2 diabetes that have problems with feet, diabetes foot or diabetic foot, some of them, if the blood can't get to one area, they have a hard time repairing that part. So that's why sometimes we just cut them, because it's better that way, because the blood is not getting there anyways. So this is the main problem with patients with diabetes.
Yeah, it seems like almost everything that can be bad in terms of health, a diabetic is just more likely to get it than a non-diabetic who is otherwise healthy. One thing I've had in my own life several times that is not pleasant are urinary tract infections. Is it your experience and understanding that urinary tract infections are frequent problems for diabetics?
Yeah, that one has two reasons. The first one is what I just said, that if there's any infection, we need your immune system to get to the location. But it's very difficult for people with diabetes. And the next one is that if you get an infection, if you have some bugs around an area, they also like sugar. They also replicate quicker if there's sugar around. So that's why there's the medications like SGLT2 inhibitors that increase patients' urination. They cause urinary tract infection because they put a lot of sugar there, and bugs love them. One more thing about the coronavirus is also the location. Because everything that is happening, you know, inflammation can happen in different places, your arms, your legs, your feet. But this one is happening in your lungs. And your lungs, you need them all the time to breathe. And this is a problem for everyone that can't breathe properly. And people with diabetes are one of them. For example, people with cardiovascular disease, that if they try to run for 10 minutes, they don't have breath anymore. So they have problem breathing, even in normal situations. People with type 2 diabetes or obese, they're in the same boat. But if you're an athlete that you can breathe really well, then maybe you can just stay like that for some time and wait for your immune system to deal with it. But if before that you already had some problems with breathing, you couldn't have enough air just sitting down, and you're, then it will be much worse for you.
So let me ask you this. If you've got a high A1C, let's say 10, 11, and through intermittent fasting and low-carb diet and some exercise and different things, and you get it down to, let's say, 5.5, a lot of people say, well, you're still diabetic. You've just brought your numbers low. But will bringing those numbers low make you less susceptible to these various afflictions? Will you be able to fight off infections, fight off disease and viruses better with a low A1C than you would have with a high A1C?
Yes, much less. Because I just told you about glycation, right? The way we measure A1C, sugar attached to your red blood cells. For example, red blood cells live for about 120 days. But other cells in your body, they also live for some time. Some maybe 2 weeks, some maybe 1 week, some maybe 2 months, some, you know? So if you have your glucose under control for a long time, most of them will be clean. There are some other ones that will still be affected a little bit, but most of them will be okay. That's why patients with diabetes, if they're going for an operation, for example, we prefer to tell them to go lower their A1C before they go to the operation. Because when you lower it, your chance of fighting anything increase. And if you have it normal for a long time, you are almost like someone who doesn't have diabetes.
Well, that's really good news, doctor, because there's a lot of people say, okay, yeah, you've lowered your A1C, but you're still a diabetic. You're still going to have all the problems. You know, you just got a better number. But what you're telling us is that you don't just have a better number. You have a much better chance to fight off disease, to live a healthy life, and so forth.
There are actually studies like that, you know, that decreasing your A1C from something like, for example, 9 to 6 or 6.5 something can decrease your risk of complications by more than 50%, even in some studies more than 70%. So it's this is a fact.
Well, that's wonderful. Let me ask you this. Suppose someone who's watching this says, well, my A1C is high. What do I do? What steps can I take to get it low? Of course, those that watch my videos kind of know where I stand on this. But just if you had someone asking you that, doctor, what would you tell them in terms of being able to quickly get those numbers lower where they could be healthier and more resistant to disease and virus and so forth?
For me, in normal situation, is the same way I told you before. Right? I told you first diet and exercise and then medications that help the disease and then some other medications that do not help the disease, but they lower your glucose, including insulin. But in this case, I put lowering A1C first for this period, for this maybe 2 or 3 months. So for me, for this time, I would not go and say, okay, you must do it with diet and exercise. If you can do it, that's great. But if you can't, we should immediately use some medications or even insulin to just get your A1C under control. But what you do later after this, you know, COVID-19, then is another story. But at this moment, for me, lowering your A1C is more important than how you do it.
Right. So to get your A1C down close to the normal range is a really, really big deal for our health, and we should make every effort possible to do that. I think that's what you're saying. Dr. Carvalho, thank you for being on our program, and you've given some excellent advice and some help, and we're glad you and your wife and your kids are all doing fine. That is good news, and let's pray this scourge passes and comes to an end, and we can be about our lives once again. Thank you, doctor.
Thank you so much.